Okay, good morning. It is, what is it, August 23rd, and we're reading in the Old Testament, and we're in 1 Kings chapter 9 today. So thankful again for you joining me. I'm always going to thank you, and glad that I have the company. And it's nice to, like I always say, look at the comments for the chapter after they're read. So this chapter starts off the reiteration of the Davidic covenant. So Solomon finished building the temple of the Lord as well as the royal palace. He completed everything he had planned to do. Then the Lord appeared to Solomon a second time, as he had done before at Gibeon. The Lord said to him, I have heard your prayer and your requests, and I have set apart this temple you have built so that my name will be honored there forever. I will always watch over it and care for it. As for you, if you will follow me with integrity and godliness, as David your father did, always obeying my commands and keeping my laws and regulations, then I will establish the throne of your dynasty over Israel forever. For I made this promise to your father David, you will never fail to have a successor on the throne of Israel. But if you or your descendants abandon me and disobey my commands and laws, and if you go and worship other gods, then I will uproot the people of Israel from this land I have given them. I will reject this temple that I have set apart to honor my name. I will make Israel an object of mockery and ridicule among the nations. And though this temple is impressive now, it will become an appalling sight for all who pass by. They will scoff and ask, why did the Lord do such terrible things to this land and to his temple? And the answer will be, because his people forgot the Lord their God, who brought their ancestors out of Egypt, and they worshiped other gods instead. That is why the Lord has brought all this disaster upon them. See, God's a jealous God. He wants us, kind of like he wants us all to himself, you know. He wants us to listen to him, obey him, keep his laws and his regulations. Yeah, it's kind of like, and if you don't, he's just gonna, you know, have terrible things happen. But if you disobey my commands, if you go and worship other gods, I'm gonna uproot the people of Israel from the land I've given them. And it's kind of like, you know, when you're following, you feel like you've been in the Word, you've been reading, you've been praying, you know, you've just been, you know, living for Christ, it's kind of like you feel stable, you know, you feel steady. Now think about when you miss, you know, your reading time or your study time or your Bible time, devotion time, prayer time, whatever you want to call it. You know, this day, you know, you do this instead. The next day you do that instead. And don't you kind of feel unsettled a little bit, like uprooted, like you're not, like you don't feel like you're grounded. So that's what I'm hearing. Like when we don't purpose after God and stay on his path, it makes me feel unsettled. Let me just put it on me. I feel a little unsettled. So this is a really good lesson here. The more we stay close to him, the more settled and grounded we're going to feel and secure. But when we turn away from him and we're not, you know, tuned in, your life does feel a little bit out of control. So that's a good word. Amen? It's a good word. It says here in verse 10, sale of towns in Israel. Now, at the end of the 20 years during which Solomon built the temple of the Lord and the royal palace, Solomon gave 20 towns in the land of Galilee to King Hiram of Tyre as a payment for all the cedar and cypress, lumber, and gold he had furnished for the construction of the buildings. Hiram came from Tyre to see the towns Solomon had given him, but he was not at all pleased with them. What kind of towns are these, my brother? He asked. These towns are worthless. So Hiram called that area Gabul, worthless, as it is still known today. Huh. Hiram has sent Solomon 9,000 pounds of gold. This is the account of the forced labor that Solomon conscripted to build the Lord's temple, the royal place, the Milo, the Wall of Jerusalem, and the cities of Hazor, Megiddo, and Gezer. The king of Egypt had attacked and captured Gezer, killing the Canaanite population and burning it down. He gave the city to his daughter as a wedding gift when she married Solomon. So Solomon rebuilt the city of Gezer. He also built up the towns of the lower Beth-horon, of lower Beth-horon, Baalath, and Tamar in the desert within his land. He built towns as supply centers and constructed cities where his chariots and horses could be kept. He built to his heart's content in Jerusalem and Lebanon and throughout the entire realm. There were still some people living in the land who were not Israelites, including Amorites, Hittites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. These were descendants of the nation that Israel had not completely destroyed. So Solomon conscripted them for his labor force, and they serve in the labor force to this day. But Solomon did not conscript any of the Israelites for forced labor. Instead, he assigned them to serve as fighting men, government officials, officers in his army, commanders of his chariots, and charioteers. He also appointed 550 of them to supervise the various projects. After Solomon moved his wife, Pharaoh's daughter, from the city of David to the new place he had built for her, he constructed the Milo. Three times each year, Solomon offered burnt offerings and peace offerings to the Lord on the altar he had built. He also burned incense to the Lord, and so he finished the work of building the temple. Later, King Solomon built a fleet of ships at Ezion-Geber, a port near Elath in the land of Edom, along the shore of the Red Sea. Aram sent experienced crews of sailors to sail the ships with Solomon's men. They sailed to Ophir and brought back to Solomon some 16 tons of gold. That's a lot of gold. Yeah, I wonder how much that would be equivalent to today. I found it interesting that there were still people living in the land that weren't Israelites when he started naming off all the ites, the Amorites, Canaanites, Perizzites, and how they became his labor force. So the Israelites were enslaved by the Egyptians years ago, and now King Solomon's got, you know, these foreigners out there working, and the Israelites had the better positions and jobs. So God can turn things around, right? That's what I'm thinking. As when I read that, starting in verse 20 to 23, I was thinking as I was reading how God can turn your whole life around and the path of your life. He can. You know, if we stay with Him and stick with Him. And being a Christian, you know, being a Christian's not easy. You've got to really dig into this thing. You know, it's a daily thing. And even for me, you know, reading, I love to read with you. But someday, like you guys know, my times are not always first thing in the morning. So you got to fight for your time with God. You got to fight for that relationship with Him and really want it. Really want to be best friends with Jesus. Do you want that? I know it feels good though. Every time I do read and when I finish, I do have more of a peace, and I feel like, you know, the one who created me is right there. He's right there, and I thank God. I thank God. So let me pray with you, and we're gonna close out that, because that was the end of the chapter. So Father, I lift up my You Can Heal family, all those who listen, who come in the comments, and who don't. You got a calling on their life, and I thank You for that. I pray that You work it out, that they will all and each and every one be obedient to You, obeying Your laws and commands, and doing what's right in Your sight, and wanting the very best life, the abundant life You have for them. May they cry out to You in times of trouble and times of need, and rejoice as well, Lord Jesus, for all that You have done for them. We thank You for being our Father, our King, our friend, our Lord, our Savior, our family. And we love You in Jesus' holy name. Amen. All right, You Can Heal family. I love you. Have a beautiful, beautiful day. Always remember, true healing begins with self-love. Why? Because God's love, and He lives on the inside of you. Bye.